Hi, all. I'm Anant Sundaram. I've been working on Azure since its inception, and it's been an amazing ride. In my current role, my team and I work on several Azure migration and modernization initiatives. And today, I'm thrilled to be hosting two Azure engineering experts from our FastTrack team who have real-life creds working day in and day out with many of you to help you adopt and move to Azure successfully.
Thank you, Nan. Hi, everyone. My name is Alejandra, and I'm a senior customer engineer here in the FastTrack for Azure organization, where I specialize in infrastructure migration and landing zone architecture design. I have been doing this for, almost 8 years now, and have assisted in migrations in landing zone designs of all sizes, from just a few dozen servers to thousands of servers.
It's great to be here, Anant, and thank you very much. So I'm Colin, and I am a principal engineer lead with our Azure FastTrack AppDev team in the Americas. And my team's focus is app modernization, you know, with our Azure PaaS platform. So we cover compute services like our Azure Kubernetes service, our Azure App Service, Azure API Management, application identity, and services like that. I've worked in the app dev space at Microsoft for over 24 years now. And actually, like you, Anant, I've worked with Azure since its inception. I was actually at the Professional Developers Conference in Los Angeles in October of 2008 when we rolled Azure out. It was formerly called Red Dog. It was just web and worker roles and storage at the time. Been using it ever since. In FastTrack, I've actually helped customers modernize and move their apps from on-prem to Azure PaaS services. And I've also helped with born-in-the-cloud applications and building microservices-based apps.
Based on your experience, Alejandra and Colin, what are some critical success factors for successful cloud adoption? Let's start with you, Alejandra, and then get to Colin next.
Sure. Thanks, Anant. In my experience, customers who prioritize assessments of their migratable state to understand early in the planning stages of the migration many things, such as what is supported by Azure VMs and managed disks, what optimization can be done to Azure VMs and managed disks, what groups of servers should be migrated together, and the priority order in which these groups of servers should be scheduled in migration waves typically result in the most successful migrations. Actually, for one of our largest customers in Canada, who I work with Colin on, they were looking at modernizing their on-premises environment to pods and containers. However, it worked best for them to move to a migration strategy first that tackled an infra migration for practical reasons, really, such as to minimize change management for their employees and the culture to get used to Azure first through IaaS, then tackle the modernization once in Azure. Another reason this customer changed to a migration to IaaS versus PaaS and containers was their time frame, as their data center contract was expiring and they needed to avoid renewal of these contracts.
Along with Alejandra, I also worked on that Canadian customer example that she mentioned, as basically they had a whole number of .NET and also Java applications that were written against SQL Server and also Postgres backends, and they wanted to modernize those and move those to our PaaS platform as a first option. That was their go-to option for modernization. Like this Canadian customer, we actually have other customers who we've seen successfully kind of modernize their apps, and they typically prioritize kind of the following. I think the first thing to prioritize is really planning. You got to plan for modernization by selecting the apps that are most important to your business. That's critical. Ask the question, is this app worth investing in? And then follow from there. The second thing would be assessments. You need to assess, if the app can actually run in a cloud platform like Azure. Most applications can. Look at the development language. Look at the database. Look at the operating system. Skilling, that would be another thing to prioritize. You need to anticipate the scale and the resiliency requirements, given the cost constraints of the organization, and plan for future growth. the agility of a managed app platform that we've been talking about really helps here, and being able to tweak these things after you go to production so you can scale and also drive down costs when you need to. Another thing that we see drive success is the ability to containerize. You know, obviously, if appropriate, but when you do containerize, it provides a lot of flexibility and portability. We see customers successfully do this through things like CI/CD and DevOps for deployment.
That was great, Alejandra and Colin. So next up, so based on your real-life experiences again, what are some common pitfalls that customers should look to avoid as they move? Let's again hear from you first, Alejandra, and then we can move to Colin.
Thanks, Anant. In my experience, common pitfalls include a poor prioritization of migration groups. For example, prioritizing migration of production versus development and test environments. Prioritizing complex workloads running legacy operating systems or with large amount of dependencies. Another common pitfall is little to no testing of migration groups prior to the final cutover. It's best to uncover issues such as a VM not booting in Azure, failed RDP access, operating system level firewall restrictions, or licensing activation issues prior to the cutover and not during the cutover window, which is already a restricted space of time. We typically want to uncover these potential issues through test migrations to an isolated temporary VNet. Last but not least, a landing zone is a very important component of any migration to either IaaS or PaaS. As some of you may know, a landing zone expands across various Azure technologies in the governance and management and networking space. So from a stakeholders alignment perspective, it's a common pitfall to have unclear direction on who will design or operate or own the different areas in a landing zone environment. It's important to have an answer prior to the migration cutover to questions such as, how will servers be monitored? How are they going to be backed up? How are they going to be patched? How are they going to be accessed from on-premises or the internet? Will traffic go through a central firewall or bastion host? Among many other things. I'll let Colin extend on this.
Thanks, Alejandra. So in my experience, we see some customers that are, you know, really just not ready for things like Kubernetes and AKS, probably a little bit too advanced for them. We see customers that are lacking the skills to properly, you know, containerize a legacy app and lacking sort of the operational expertise to monitor and kind of support that kind of the sophisticated platform. So I've seen customers fail in certain circumstances, you know, with technologies like Kubernetes. For these instances and these kinds of customers, we have simpler platform options that are often a better fit organizationally. Things like app services, things like maybe Azure Container Instances, another great service that's simpler to work with, or possibly even our upcoming in-preview container apps service that'll go right at sort of these workloads. Another kind of common pitfall with app modernization during a move is properly planning for all the dependencies that the application has, like the databases, the external interfaces. For a large kind of multi-app migration project, stakeholder alignment is always one of the biggest hurdles.
That was really wonderful, Alejandra and Colin. I myself remember as an IT practitioner how the moment of cutting over to a new solution, in this case Azure, represents a real moment of truth for our customers. And I'm so glad that you folks work side by side with customers in those critical moments. Thank you. Next up, do you see customers who need to have some of their workloads continue to run on-premises? Any, you know, use cases that might need them to stay back, even as they're moving a lot of the workloads to Azure? And how have you guided such customers? Colin, let's start with you on this one.
Yeah, thanks, Anand. And so I've worked with a large automobile manufacturer actually last year to solve an issue where that they had in their assembly plants. So these plants, these assembly plants for this manufacturer exist all over the world. And inside of these plants, they actually were running on-premise SQL servers that house important assembly data that actually must stay local for a whole bunch of reasons inside of the plant. It's been really hard for this customer to manage all of those SQL instances around the world, upgrading them, keeping them operationally there and functional. And so as a solution to kind of this challenge, they leveraged Azure Arc for Kubernetes to run Kubernetes clusters locally inside of their plants, and then to run all of those SQL instances as SQL managed instances. This is actually in preview today. But what this did is it enabled the customer to kind of manage all of those on-premises Kubernetes and SQL resources through the Azure portal, through Azure Arc. And what this allowed them to leverage was the power of the cloud. They could then use the portal to spin up new databases, for example. They also had like built-in capabilities like high availability, backup, and monitoring, all part of that on-prem SQL Server managed instance that they now were getting through the portal. This gave them consumption-based cloud billing, another simplification of how they were doing it before. And they, in addition, got the power of Azure Policy for governance, as well as Microsoft Defender for security. So this is a really great sort of set of cloud capabilities that were now available to solve this manufacturing problem.
That's great, Colin. And I do, yes, have quite a good amount of my customers which stay in a hybrid architecture where they concurrently manage their on-premises and Azure environments. Some of these customers are looking to start POCs already to leverage Azure Arc for servers, mainly to onboard these on-premises servers to Azure's control plane. Actually, about a year ago, I helped this insurance company in Germany POC the use of Arc for servers for a small group of 5 dev test servers. Their goal, though, was to eventually onboard an environment of close to 2,000 servers using Azure Arc to leverage Azure Update Management and monitoring.
Wonderful. Thanks again, Alejandra and Colin. You know, the hybrid architecture that you mentioned is coming up more and more with a lot of customers and solutions like Azure Arc. It appears are the way to go for those multi-cloud edge and hybrid environments. And finally, a lot of our ISV customers are looking to move their SaaS businesses to Azure. So how does FastTrack for Azure help those ISV friends of ours SaaS enable their applications and move them successfully? Colin, this one is for you as well.
Many of our ISV customers in FastTrack come to us and ask us for guidance on how to, you know, properly achieve multi-tenancy in their SaaS-based solutions that they're trying to enable. This is a, you know, this is a common architectural pattern and problem, and we're actually providing lots of guidance here. It's a hard problem given the obvious security, privacy, scale, and, you know, resiliency concerns, undoubtedly. But what we actually have is some great document coverage for this in our Azure Architecture Center, where we cover the various Azure techniques that can be used for this problem, whether it's a single shared database where you have all of your tenants in one database, or perhaps a database per customer scenario. So the various different types of problems are all kind of laid out in our guidance. Secondly, FastTrack is currently building a reference architecture led by our ISV team to help jumpstart ISVs that want to properly incorporate these sort of common requirements into some software that they want to build out. So we're helping customers jumpstart here, and we'll be delivering something along those lines.
Thank you both, Alejandra and Colin, for joining and bringing to light all this wonderful information and insights. You know, the FastTrack for Azure team has such wonderful experiences of working with customers, which is always so valuable and refreshing to hear right from the trenches. We have tons of guidance and a great tool set in Azure Migrate if you want to give it a shot yourself. Or we have a comprehensive program called the Azure Migration and Modernization Program that offers you expert help, resources, and guidance at each and every step of the way. And super easy to nominate yourself to it. Just go to azure.com/AMMP and just fill a few fields and you're in. We look forward to seeing you leverage these great resources for your next Azure Migration and Modernization project.